show what I gave my kids for Christmas.
A dog!
Puppy!
Puppy! Yes, I'm a good dad. I bought my kids a puppy for Christmas. And my house thanks me so much. We've been planning this for a long time. Once we've got our house, got a nice little fence here in the back with some grass, we have a puppy, we don't have to tie it up, don't have to put in the kennel. We got a puppy for our kids, it's awesome. They came walking out slowly, and it's like, puppy! It was awesome, you know, and we've been planning this for a couple weeks now. As many of you know, when you get a new puppy, it's got a lot of growing up to do. I haven't had a dog in my life since 86. So it's a lot of learning for me since I was like 5 or 6. So there's been a lot of peeing on the ground, or like the carpet. And there's been a lot of biting things that she shouldn't be. I think she chewed up some Polly Pocket toys, maybe swallowed half a Polly Pocket hat. Not to mention my power cable for my MacBook that got chewed up and destroyed. Thank goodness I found one in storage from another church that blessed us with some of their stuff. And also, there's not a lot of good understanding of commands. You know, sit, wait, no. All it just makes her more excited. Puppies are a lot of fun, but they're also a lot of work. And it doesn't help that my kids just like run and flee and scream when the dog's coming after them, because our little puppy who's 10 weeks old has already owned my kids. Like, we may be training them, my wife and I may be training the dog, but these kids are training her that she's the monster and she rules the yard and the house. So it's very difficult. Maybe you've experienced this sometime with one of your animals, and you've had a dog, or a cat, or a child that does these things, you know. Yes, maybe you were that child who did these things around your house. As I thought about this week, the question that came to me was, am I behaving like this spiritually? Am I making messes in God's plans that He has? Am I finding things that I shouldn't be? Am I listening to His commands? And if I'm still a puppy spiritually, I mean, that's forgivable, that's how puppies are. But if, you know, if I don't know any better, but if I claim to be a grown-up spiritually in my walk with God and mature, then I need to check myself. Jesus said to the Pharisees at one point here in John chapter 9, verse 41, He said, "If you were blind, then you would have no guilt. But now that you say we see, your guilt remains." Tonight, we're going to do kind of a spiritual check of ourselves to see where we are in our maturity. I think you've got a kind of a glimpse of that, what's going on the stage here tonight. And I don't want to be me kind of here giving some guilt trip. I want it to be God speaking to you as I share kind of what I've been experiencing, what I've been thinking through, what I've been wrestling with. And to emphasize that, I want to pray. I want to ask that God be the one that speaks to you tonight, not you want some guilt trip from what Pastor John shared. So if you bow your head, let's pray one more time and ask that God will speak to His word. If you'll join me. God, I love you. You're beautiful. I can trust you in your goodness. And so tonight, God, I lay my life before you. And I ask you to do a spiritual checkup to see how I'm doing, to see how I'm growing and maturing. And God, would you help me to be honest with you, even though you know everything already, that I'd be good in receiving anything you pass back to me tonight. As we read your word, as we discuss this, as we think about where we are in our development, would you, God, help us to see what next steps we are need to take as a church, but especially as individuals. So I pray that you speak tonight, Holy Spirit, through all that's going on, we pray this in Jesus Christ's name. Tonight's message is going to deal a lot with individually where we are and as a church. And to start off, I want to give you our church mantra for 2014. Now some of you are like, "Oh, mantra, you can't use that in church." We're just going to play with the word mantra, okay? Don't really let it humble this if you sleep at night, okay? Our church mantra, they're saying for 2014, is deep and wide. Say it with me. Deep and wide. Simple, see? You're done. It's an easy class here. Okay? Engage church. This may seem odd to have like a saying, but sometimes having a simple saying to sum things up helps us when remembering our goal, when there's so much information that goes around that. But deep and wide is our goal. Now let's start with deep tonight, okay? Where are you spiritually? And that's what I have up here. Are you in a bassinet? Are you in a high chair? Are you in a booster seat? Or are you an adult who's mature and able to use that nice school there? I want to go to scriptures left them speak to us tonight. We're going to come back and define what those might represent spiritually in our life. So if you got a Bible, feel free to turn there. If you got a phone, feel free to pop it out into the Bible app. We've got it printed in those little handouts, and it'll also be on the screen. Whatever you want to use is great. And if I didn't mention before, you're welcome to use your smartphones, take pictures, tweet stuff, whatever you need to. Use them to study God's Word and share what's going on tonight. Let's look at 1 Corinthians chapter 3. This is Paul writing to the church in Corinth, which had a lot of growing up to do. They're one of the most dysfunctional churches that there was. Here's what he wrote in chapter 3, verses 1, 2, and 3. "But I, brothers, could not address you as spiritual people, but as people of the flesh, as infants in Christ. I fed you with milk, not solid food, for you were not ready for it. And even now, you are not yet ready, for you are still of the flesh. But while there is jealousy and strife among you, are you not of the flesh and behaving only in a human way?" Highlight a couple things in that scripture that he points out about this difference about being infants. Milk and solid food, this type of teaching that he wants to bring there. In verse 2 he says, you're not ready. Verse 3, you're still the flesh. An infant is acting in the flesh. And what is that? Jealousy and strife, he lines out. Behaving only as a human. And I think only as a child. Like, when my children do childish things, I'm like, okay, they're a child, you know? We have to ask ourselves, are we acting spiritually as children? Or have we matured in this walk that we're going on with Christ? Paul writes again, actually not Paul, in Hebrews, the writer of the book of Hebrews gives us some more of this. I want you to turn to Hebrews now, chapter 5. And this lines out a few more specifics on maybe what this is looking like, infants, adults, maturity, milk, solid food. Hebrews chapter 5, verse 12. "For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the basic principles of the oracles of God. You need milk, not solid food." Same, same. "For everyone who lives on milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, since he's a child. But solid food is for the mature." Now he lines out. "The mature, for those who have their powers of discernment trained by constant practice to distinguish good from evil." Goes on, chapter 6, "Therefore let us leave the elementary doctrine of Christ and go on to maturity, not laying in foundations of repentance from dead works and faith toward God, and of instruction about washing, the laying on of hands, the resurrection of the dead, the eternal judgment." Those are things he said we're not going to do again. We're going on to maturity. Now, you've got those two scriptures right there on your handout in your Bible on the screen. We're going to lay out kind of how I see these playing out in the bassinet, the high chair, the booster seat, and this. And I want to invite you to see maybe where you think you are. I'm not going to make you stand up with each spot. I'm not going to embarrass you tonight. This is a conversation between you and God as we look through this. Where am I spiritually? So first one, we get the slide for that. What's the bassinet? As I put these scriptures and I see how they kind of fit into ours. So go ahead and put a slide up. I got that first one. A bassinet. We have a new believer. A baby. I stole this from the Day family. It's like a little mini crib. It's portable. Okay? A bassinet. Like a crib. That'd be someone who's a new believer, little spiritual experience with God, jealousy and strife is still common, no regular spiritual routines in their life. That's what the writer Paul was saying in 1 Corinthians. You're acting like infants, because that's what infants do. They don't know how to share their toys. There's a lot of jealousy with them. And sometimes there's a lot of that in adults. Maybe roommates, maybe with people in your class, getting better grades, or whatever. Ask yourself, am I in that category still the way that I'm acting? No regular routine? I mean, like, the Bible, prayer, quiet time like that. Where am I? Next level here, the high chair. Someone who understands the basic principles of God, that's what the Hebrews writer says. Understands the basic principles of God. Has the power of discernment of good and evil. Engaging in some prayer and Bible reading, and has shared their faith ones. I think it's a big part of growing up, because not only do you know it, but you're sharing it. Moving on to the next level. High chair. It's a cute little pink one I borrowed. I stole right out of your car, Tony. Thanks. Has read the Bible and understands the doctrine of Christ, repentance, faith, and not works, resurrection of dead, eternal judgment, kind of end times, and has shared their faith multiple times. I don't mean you've gone street witnessing and you've got someone saved, but you've made efforts to talk to your friends who don't know about Jesus. That's kind of where I see that growth. You've gone from just knowing the basics about how to be saved or what it means to have the church, to understand the doctrines and the deeper things about repentance and faith, end time stuff. You have a bit more knowledge about what the Bible really means when it talks about these things. And the last one, being an adult, someone mature, you don't need any little help in your seat. Able to teach the Word of God. That was Paul's goal when he wrote. Able to teach the Word of God. Praying regularly, not just at meals, which is great, but I'm saying you shouldn't do that. But not just at meals. And sharing their faith regularly. You can define how regularly means. Once a day, once a month, once a minute, whatever works for you. Set the bar right here. No. But regularly practicing these things that are important as Christians. Leaving that slide up for a bit, could you imagine where am I in this process? I know where my kids and my dog are. Dust, baby, still just making a mess. Doesn't know how not to bite something that isn't hers. My kids are a little older, physically mature. The question is spiritually, where are we and how we're doing our walk with Christ? And our mantra this year is deep and wide. So this is getting more mature, more deep in our faith with Christ. Now for several months I've been saying that Engage will be launching small groups in January. Guess what? It's January. Here we go. Alvin and I, Pastor Alvin and I, have been talking and praying about what God would have us do to grow as a church in the depth of our spiritual walk, to become mature believers. Besides personal time with God that you do at your home, we believe the best thing to do to grow in maturity is small groups. What we're doing right now is beneficial, but it can only take you so far. We need groups that share our struggles and our triumphs in life, where we can mourn and celebrate with one another, where we can pray together for each other. Groups where we study and apply the Word of God, groups that encourage us directly in God's ways for our life. Because we believe that God has not created us to do this alone on earth. We're meant to be a church, a body that meets together and helps each other. The church was established to be a place where we can encourage one another in the real areas we're dealing with. I can't ask every single one of you guys what you're dealing with tonight and pray for you. We don't have the time for that. That's why we have those groups. People who know you well, know what you're dealing with, and can do that for you. This month, Engage is going to be launching small groups. Today we have a table in the fellowship area. You may have seen when you walk by. I've got a bunch of signs and information about small groups. We're going to be offering them throughout this year. Some of them are short-term, some of them are long-term, some of them are once a week, some of them are once a month. A lot of different kinds of groups because we believe that different people have different needs. Different time, availability, different kind of things that they're interested in. It will benefit you to sign up for at least one group, to be involved in one small group of spiritual leaders that will help you in your walk. It's not a requirement by any means, simply because we believe that you will benefit greatly from them. Okay? I'm not going to check whose names are on there, whose weren't tomorrow. Don't worry. I'm just saying I'm doing this because I think it'll benefit you. It benefited me, and I can remind you. I'm going to ask Alvin to come here and share. He's going to be leading one group this coming year. There's a lot of groups on that list, but I'm kind of have everybody come here and share. But I want Alvin to share a little bit about what his group is going to look like to get an idea of kind of what a small group might be like. It's Pastor Alvin.
Thanks, John. How's it going, everybody? So like John said, we're starting small groups in a couple weeks, and it's something that I'm really, really excited about because it's an opportunity that we have to be church more or outside of these walls here. Church isn't just from 4:30 to 8:30 here on Sunday. It's every single day of your life when you're in community with other believers. And when we do small groups, that's a chance where we can practice the one another's, to love one another, show honor to one another, to encourage one another. So, as good as this time is right now, like John said, we don't have the opportunity to get very deep with one another. But that's what we can do in small groups. We can have that time to talk about those deep things, to have those conversations, those long prayer times where we can be intimate with one another, where we can be honest with each other about what's really going on, what we're struggling with, what God is teaching us, and you know, where we feel like God is calling us in our lives. And in my small group, I plan on having it once a week at my house. We're going to have some dessert there. So my wife makes a pretty awesome, she calls it a dump cake. It's kind of like a cobbler. It's pretty awesome. Dump cake. Eat it up. It's up there. So we'll have dessert, and then we'll hang out for maybe about half an hour, talk stories, see how everyone's doing that week. So we can all catch up and, you know how we can pray for each other. Then we'll dive into the Word for about 35 minutes. And in my small group, I call it a Bible study walkthrough. So what we're going to do is we're going to choose a book of the Bible, and we're just going to go through it verse by verse. So we're going to understand what this book is talking about as a whole. We're not going to be jumping around. We're going to just walk through it and have a very big picture of what a book is talking about. So we're going to learn some Bible study methods as well, and that, how to study Scripture, how you can interpret Scripture. So that's what my group is going to be doing. And there's going to be a bunch of other groups offered by John, and some groups at the BCM, and some from Young Life. So if you're not plugged into a small group, I encourage you to do so, because it's an opportunity where, like the proverb says, iron sharpens iron as one brother to another. So this is an opportunity where you can grow in Christ and be in community, be honest with people about where you are spiritually. And sign up. It'll be a great time.
Please don't sign up for every group. You may even stress that. One of the things I see a lot of times, people come to me this semester, I'm going to do everything because it's all so good. And then, like, 1 month later, I can't do this one, I can't do this one, and then I'm just burnt out because I tried too much in front. Pick one that you really feel like I can invest in and commit into for 6 months, you know, a semester, whatever. And let your life be poured into and poured into the others in that group for a time. This isn't like you're signed up for life here. We're going to buy these every 6 months. Some of these are going to be 3 month groups, another 3 month, both short term, long term. So look at it carefully. Signing up today doesn't mean you're in, it means you're interested. We'll have it sign up again next Sunday, and we'll launch them after next Sunday, okay? Our mantra for 2014 as a church is
deep
and wide. Okay, so that was deep. Small groups, we're going to get deep this year. We'll be talking about wide. I shared with you in the last 2 weeks that God has revealed to me our need for us to up our game in our area of reaching those who don't know Jesus. And I've been praying about what God wants us to do, and I thank you for your prayers that I asked for this 2014. Put the black side up. I want to share with you now where I feel that He's leading us. But I want to look at a scripture first. This is a scripture from last week, so go ahead and take a look at Luke chapter 5. Luke chapter 5, verse 27. This is Jesus, who's just called Matthew, what we've seen the story as Levi. Luke 5, verse 27. Okay. After this, he went out and saw a tax collector named Levi, also Matthew, sitting at the tax booth, and he said to him, "Follow me." And leaving everything, he rose and followed him. And Levi made a great feast in his house. There was a large company of tax collectors and others. Other scriptures tell us others being sinners. Not some nice people. They were gathered there for a feast at his house, and at the table with them was Jesus. And the Pharisees and their scribes grumbled at his disciples, saying, "Why do you eat and drink with these tax collectors and sinners?" And Jesus answered them, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. What happened in the story is that basically Matthew got saved. His calling is he left behind his way of doing life, which was a tactic that was someone who cheated a lot of people. So they were known for kind of how they all did it, that's how they made the little extra on the side. Matthew left his life of sin, followed Jesus, became a follower of Jesus, became saved. And right after he did, he invited all of his lost friends and his new believer friends to come together into one great big party. And when Matthew got saved, they didn't, you know, grab a camera and sign up for a contract and say, I'm going to be a televangelist, I'm going to preach to the world, because that's what I need to do. That was cool for you guys. No, he gathered people together in his home. It's simple. It's easy. It doesn't take public speaking skills. It doesn't take much except that you know some people from both sides and you bring them together and they can see each other. We're going to call this a Matthew party. Someone gets saved, they bring together their lost friends and their saved friends in the same place to hang out. And this is going to be one of the big pieces for us in growing life. In 2014, one of our outreach plans is not going to depend solely on getting them to come through that door. That is not our outreach plan, just to get them to come through that door, because it won't work. Because of this, do you like to go to a place where you don't know anybody? No, nobody likes to go to a place they don't know anybody. If you do, you're brave. Good job. Brave. Got some guests here. Props to you guys. Nobody wants to go to a place they don't know anybody, and they especially don't want to go to a church they don't know anybody. That's awkward. What if they're weird? What if their pastor, like, just, you know, doesn't... anybody use the Apple's cards or his message? That's weird. You don't know. People don't want to come into a first time like that. And so we need to do something different to reach them, to show them that we're somewhat learning, I guess. So here's what I want to do. We're going to develop events that take place outside of our building for the purpose of making relationships, connections, to share Jesus with them, and then invite them to church. They need to know you first, and the kind of people that are in your church, before they're going to give us a chance in this place. It's only a small percentage that's actually going to walk through those doors not knowing anybody, any one person. Here's an example. I mentioned in our announcement Super Bowl Sunday. Here's what this would look like. On Super Bowl Sunday, we're not going to have a party here in this building. I know, I really want to, you know, scream and shout when the 49ers beat the Broncos, but we're not going to be able to do it together here, okay? Sorry. Here's how it's going to work. Because your friends don't want to go somewhere they are unfamiliar with, and they know there won't be any beer at the party here. They're not going to come here and go to those kind of outreach friends. Jesus' friends, he's reaching those kind of people that are out there living life. They know what the culture is like in here. They're not going to sit there for a year first for a little while. They know what that looks like. They need to meet them in a place outside where there's safety, where they feel comfortable in your home. So what I want you guys to do is hopefully we're going to be intentional in hosting parties in our homes. I want people to partner with other engaged people. Say, hey, I want to host a party at my home. And another person will say, dude, that's awesome. I want to come help you. I'm going to cook this, and I'll bring this decoration. We'll have a great time. Together, we'll partner to make an excellent party. You bring your friends. I'll bring my friends. It'll be awesome. We'll have a real fun time. I don't want you at halftime to get up and open the Bible and preach for 10 minutes to them. That would be awkward. I mean, if you really feel the Lord getting to you, go ahead, but I don't think it'll go over very well. But what I want you to do at these parties is to get to know new people and share who you are and share where you met each other. And I'll make it my goal to get to as many parties as I can. Even if it means missing some of the whooping that the 49ers are going to do on the Broncos. I will travel to each. Did I say that again? I'm sorry. I'm really sorry, Daniel and Ron. I'm really sorry. It's all right. We probably won't even make it, so. I'll be there to help meet your friends, share what's going on. Hey, what do you do for work? Oh, yeah, this is what I do for work. Oh, that's awkward. Yeah, I know. It's all right. You get out there, you share who you are, and let them know that you're a real person. I think this is going to work really well. And I want to apply this model to several areas of the year. 4th of July. Let's host a bunch of 4th of July parties at our homes. Halloween, Thanksgiving, Christmas, New Year's. There's so much opportunity. I went to Kareen's house like 3 times in the last month and a half. You guys throw excellent parties. I met lots of new people. What's that?
All of them. number one.
That's right. There you go. We want this to work, and I think it will. But it'll take you guys saying, I'll do this. It'll take us saying, we'll walk across, we'll invite our neighbors. It'll take you partnering and say, hey, look, I can't do this in my house for some reason, but let me partner with you and help bring and make this amazing time. When I come to your party, I want to meet people who I don't know and who don't know Jesus. If we just invite all of our friends who are Christians together, we're missing the point. Is there nothing wrong with that? We do that here in church, we do that when we go camping and other fun times, but I want to be intentional in some of these events to really reach some new people who don't know about Jesus. If we don't do that, we will never grow wide. And our mantra for this year is deep and wide. We want to grow deep with our maturity and our smallness. We're going to go wide with the people that we reach. And the goal is not just to have them in a party, you know, but hopefully they meet some people from this church. Say at Super Bowl Sunday, they meet your friends. They already knew you, but they meet your friends when you're in the party. Oh, they're kind of nice. So they meet a little week from now or 2 weeks from now, you meet them again. Hey, you know that guy you met from our church? He and I were going to Easter Sunday at Super Bowl. We'd love to have you come join us. Or if it's 4th of July, hey, you know, we're doing our fall kickoff for the new semester. We'd love to have you come. Or Christmas time, we're having some kind of thanks. It's been a lead up to that event. Or something else, we're going spear fishing, or we're going to have a bar in the park for kids. You get them to come to other events that way. Because people don't want to go places they don't know people. It's not fun. Unless you're weird, which I think you guys are weird. That's all right. I love you. Okay, let me share a few more things. Deep and wide. I'm taking tonight to really kind of give you guys some vision for where I feel God is leading us. I've been praying a lot about this. It's not a Hollywood presentation, I know, tonight, but you know, it'll do, okay? I feel like doing another one right now, but I'll stay here, okay? I want to share three more big things for you with you that I think God is doing engaged, and I want to look forward to as this year goes forward. We haven't even made a year old yet as a church, but I think God's got some exciting stuff. Number one, if you were here last evening, that YWAM group that's here, they're helping us do some outreach on campus, including that mission team. We have 5 mission teams coming to help our church in the next 6 months, which is amazing because we need help reaching people. YWAM group's going to help us this week getting on campus and getting out to the park. We have a team coming during spring break that's going to help us get on campus, reach people, and also do a youth camp. We're going to have our band, we're going to do a bunch of stuff for junior high and high schoolers. We have 3 teams coming this summer doing VBS outreach. 1 VBS here, a couple park outreach to promote, and hopefully another VBS on a park outlook, because I believe that people have a hard time coming in here. So let's take it out there and do the whole event there. I'm going to be a little busy this summer. I would love for you guys to join us in one of those meetings. Say, look, I love kids, or I hate kids, let's do something else. I'll help you with this, you know. Find something you feel excited to partner with and get on board and give what you have. Number 2, we've been talking with the owner of this building. We had to go to 2 services last semester when the students were all here. It was kind of so full. We've been planning, we've been preparing, we've been talking. We're hoping to go through this wall in around August. It's not official yet, but I'm hoping to give back to that bay and to take a double bay in the back around August. So we can continue to meet together in one place. And hopefully it won't be so hot like it is today again. It was like cold last week when it happened. As students come back, as families come back from the vacation, the school starts, we believe that God has a plan for us to do more than just fill this space. Because I know there's people out there who need to hear about Jesus still. But I believe that God wants us to do more. So we're hopefully going to take the door right through here. The double bay on the back side. We'll use that as our new sanctuary. That's my goal. Pray for us on that. Because the people who own the building, their entire supplies are all back there. They need to build a new building over there. So pray that the county passes all their permits. The plans go through. They can build that quick so we can launch our fall launch back there August or September. You got time to mark that on your calendar? I'll need to paint again. A lot of you guys were here when we got to paint these walls, put the carpet in. It was an exciting time as we began to see and envision what God might have for our church. That was number 2. Number 3, I want to announce that people have been asking this. We're going to begin plans for a mission trip in the summer of 2015. It's a year and a half away, I know, dang it. Really wrestled about doing it this summer, just wasn't what I think God wanted us to do right away. We still got a lot of things we want to establish here. But you guys have been with me for a while, you know my heart. I love going overseas because God calls us not just to our city, but to the ends of the earth. And so right now I want to declare that summer of 2015, we're making plans to go overseas. Proudly to Asia for 2 to 3 weeks. I've been to Thailand, I've been to Nepal and India and the Philippines. I have friends in each of those places. I have friends in China and Cambodia who would all love us to come there in ministry. We're going to begin praying and seeking, and I ask for praying with us where God would have us go. We may even do 2 mission trips back to back. We go to 1 country for 2 to 3 weeks. Then for those of you who go back to work, you can go. If you want to keep going, you might go to a second place. In 3 weeks, I have my one of my mentors, my youth pastor, Tim Kerrigan, is going to be here sharing about what he's doing. He does ministry in China with youth. Who knows? Maybe we'll end up there. We don't know. Begin praying with us about that. Begin setting aside maybe money or just your calendar. Like in June of 2015, I'm going to set that aside because I want to go overseas and share what God has blessed me with, the knowledge of who Jesus Christ is. What is our mantra this year at Engage?
Deep
and
wide.
Deep and wide. I want us, church, to grow deep in our faith, rooted in what it means to be a follower of Jesus Christ, and sharing that with our community. Growing wide by throwing events at our homes, in the parks, in the community that draw people to Jesus through our lives. We are the example. They're not going to want to come if you're like snooty. Anyway. Let our lives be growing deep and wide this year. May our church do that. That's my goal this year. I'm going to evaluate everything we do by that. Are the people that are coming here growing deep? And are we growing wide by reaching more people this year? And if we're not, then I want to change what we're doing.